So what we have seen in the last lessons is that we may have a time domain model, which is the representation of the model in terms of states x, so differential equations in x, which is the solution. Okay, u is the input and y is the output, the controlled output. On the other end, we have also parallelly domain Laplace domain model, or frequency, also known as frequency domain model. Frequency because the variable s is a complex variable, and when s is restricted to the imaginary axis, actually is j omega, where omega as the physical minimum of frequency. So for this reason, we say also frequency domain. And this model is given by an algebraic representation, not differential. Okay, in general, the functions of S here are, as we have seen, rational functions of S. Okay, then we have also seen how to pass from one model to the other using Laplace transform inverse Laplace transform for doing many types of different things, like for example calculate forced and unforced responses, calculate the natural modes, and so on. Moreover, on its own, they have also a characterization in terms of stability. So we have seen how to define and characterize as Lyapunov stability for these models. In particular, we have seen this for the time domain model. So basically, stability of equilibrium points. And a particular case of stability, Lyapunov stability, is asymptotic stability. Okay, which in particular for the model we are considering amounts to, as we have seen, to the property that the spectrum of A is in C minus, so the real part of the eigenvalues are all negative. If you remember that actually we have many times mentioned the fact that eigenvalues are always mapped in the poles, into the poles, in Laplace domain. So while this is a property on the time model, on the time domain model, actually we can state an equivalent property on the Laplace domain model using exactly this property. So the fact that the eigenvalues of A are mapped into the poles of what? So you see that basically the role of A is played in the domain Laplace, in the Laplace domain by the matrix phi S. Remember that phi S is Si minus A inverse, and it is exactly the Laplace domain the Laplace transform of the exponential, the matrix exponential e to a t, which is exactly the matrix which transforms the initial state into the solution. Remember the solution x of t. Okay, so on the other end, what we can say is that using this fact, so the eigenvalues are mapped into the poles of phi. Okay. So asymptotic stability, which in time domain is equivalent to the eigenvalues of A being with negative real part, can be restated in the Laplace domain by saying that the poles of phi of S must be with negative real part. Okay, so you can think of asymptotic stability basically not only in time domain using the condition on eigenvalues of A, so real negative part, but also in Laplace domain on the matrix phi of S, for which the poles must be all with negative real part. So this corresponds exactly to the asymptotic stability property in Laplace domain. Okay. So besides this, we have also, so asymptotic stability is a property of the free, of the unforced behavior of the system. So zero input. So if we zero the input, we have, if this is the case, asymptotic stability in the sense that the trajectory, the solutions tends to zero asymptotically. Okay. On the other hand, we can also study the behavior of the solution with respect to the input, instead of with respect to the initial state x0. So zeroing the initial state and studying what kind of stability makes sense with respect to the input. So by doing this, we have introduced the definition of input to state and input output stability. Okay, we have seen that input-output stability so we just see the case of input-output stability because on the other end it's from the practical point of view it's the one we look at in general. The input-output stability, if you remember the definition, amounts to the fact that if we apply a bounded input to the system, the output, in particular the forced output, is bounded. So this is the characterization in time domain, which is the characterization in Laplace domain. Again, for the same reason for which the eigenvalues are mapped in the poles in Laplace domain, of the matrices of the transfer matrices. In particular here we have look at the eigenvalues of A which are mapped into the poles of WS, the input output transfer function. Okay, so while this is time domain, in Laplace domain, we'll have this. Let's give the conditions actually. Okay, so basically we have two necessary and sufficient conditions as we have seen. The first we have seen one, which is in terms of poles at W. So the poles of WS, which is the input output transfer function, are in C minus. So what is the correspondent in time domain condition? You have to look at the what we have in time domain from W, which is the matrix WT. So when we have input to output stability in time domain, well, remember that while in general we look at the poles in Laplace domain, we look at the eigenvalues, or in particular, which is the same, if you remember, at the modes, which are inside these matrices. So in particular here, we have to look at the modes inside WT. So all the modes in WT must be convergent. If you remember the modes which are in WT, these modes are the observable or excitable ones. So all excitable and observable modes are convergent. So, this is the way we determine the input-output stability in time domain. We have to look at the modes and see if these modes are convergent, going to zero in time. On the other hand, in Laplace domain, this corresponds to look at the poles of WS and look and check if these poles are in C minus, so negative real part. Okay. So in general, when we'll work with the time domain model, in particular with the state space model, okay, so in some sense looking at the state, here we will use obviously asymptotic stability. So what we want to in general guarantee is the asymptotic stability of this system as a first requirement. Okay, so we look at the eigenvalues of A. Okay, and in such sense we have to guarantee that its eigenvalues are in C minus, negative real part. Okay, obviously, by doing this, you see, I have to look at the internal model of this. Okay. I have to look at the internal model of this input-output representation. Okay, input-output. So the internal model is the characterization of the system in terms of the state, so the differential equations in X. But you see that actually the only accessible points in general are the inputs, are the outputs. You don't have access to the state. Okay, but however, it's an important property, the fact that the system be internally asymptotically stable. Okay, so it is essential that be asymptotically stable in the sense that the eigenvalues of the matrix A be in C minus. But remember that what we observe is the input-output behavior because we look at the system from the output. We are not observing the state. So for this reason, we say internal model must be asymptotically stable because actually it's some kind of internal stability we are looking at, okay? On the other hand, the input-output stability is the proper object we have to use for saying that a system is stable from the input-output view. So we see from the output that the system is stable. So when we look at the input-output stability, we are not looking at internal stability, but at a kind of stability which is what we observe from the external point of view. Okay. So by doing this, obviously we are characterizing the system only with its input-output transfer function. Okay. So remember also that asymptotic stability implies, we have seen this in the last lesson, asymptotic stability always implies input-output stability. So this internal stability always implies input-output stability, but not the converse. And we have seen this, okay? The reason is that some eigenvalues of A may be not poles of WS. So what may happen and should not happen is that you stabilize the system from the input-output point of view. So you get an input-output stable system, but an internally unstable system. And the reason is that you have all the poles of W in C minus, but some eigenvalue of A not in C minus. Okay. So we will get back rather often on this point during this course, because in general you have to ensure not only input-output stability, but obviously you have to avoid internal instability. Okay. So in general, what you guarantee is input-output stability. So bounded input gives bounded output. And you do this in general, guaranteeing that the poles of WS are in C minus. But you have to look also at what happens internally, in particular in the matrix A. So in the eigenvalues of A. Okay. In some sense, you have some eigenvalues of the matrix A, which may be hidden from the output. So you have to be sure that these hidden dynamics are stable, not unstable, okay? And we will see that this may happen in many situations during our lessons and exercises, especially, for example, when you cancel some dynamics. We will see how this may happen. Could happen. Okay, so we will get back on this point later. So remember that input-output stability, but you have also to look at internal stability. However, what you look from the outside is the input-output stability, not the internal stability. Okay. So now we are at this point. So what we have now? So we have seen that and asymptotically stable system . So for example, in the X-plane, this is the origin. This means that you have, in general, a behavior for which the solutions tend to the origin. This is the initial state. So whatever is the initial state, your solutions will tend to zero, asymptotic stability. Now, an asymptotic stable, an asymptotically stable system, how responds to a non-zero input? It's obvious that if you are forcing an asymptotically stable system, the solutions in general will not tend anymore to zero because we are forcing the system. So you can see this clearly if you apply, for example, if you take a very simple example. Of an asymptotically stable system, which is this. This is asymptotically stable because you see you have an eigenvalue in minus one. As a matter of fact, the solution is very simple and is given by this. And you see that, as a matter of fact, we have an asymptotically stable system because for all x0, the solution tends to zero, asymptotically. Now, force the system with a step input. One. So at time zero, one. What happens to x of t? You see that x of t cannot tend to zero asymptotically. And the reason is that, imagine to replace in your solutions, in your equation, zero. The constant solution zero. So you will see that zero is not even a solution of the system. And the reason is that 0 equals 0 plus 1, false. So this means that the solution will not go to 0 anymore. And will tend to something else. This something else is what we call steady state solutions. Okay. Steady state solution on response. And what happens if we look at the graph of x of t is that is the new limit of x of t will be a non-zero limit, but some constant limit, which is non-zero. And is this value. We are also able to determine the value of this constant value here. And what happens to the solution will be a thing like this. So you have, for example, x0 here. So you start at time 0, and the solution will tend to this constant non-zero value. So this value, which is the limit, the new limit of the solution, which we will call XSS, stands for steady state response, is exactly the new limit of the solution x of t. This limit depends on the input we are applying, which in this case is a unit step function. And it is independent of the initial state. So whatever is your initial state, you will observe that the limit will be the same. So this is an important fact, because whatever is the initial state, your solutions will tend to the same value. So it's clear that this value XSS is not dependent on the initial state, because it's the same for all the solutions, and depends only on the input U we are applying to the system. This means that if we change the input, for example, instead of 1, we apply 2, we are changing the steady state response. But this will change only because we are changing the input. Okay. So this is a very important notion in control, because the steady state solutions are exactly correspond to the steady state behavior of your system when you apply a certain input or command. So if you are commanding the system with a certain input, you will have, obviously the system is asymptotically stable, the response of this system will be basically of this form. So after some time, you will see that the solutions will be close all to a certain behavior, which is the steady state behavior of the system. Okay. So for this reason, in general, it is also easy. We'll see many ways of doing this, but finally, we have many easy ways of even calculating the steady state solutions once the input is given. Okay. And basically is what we will do in this lesson. First, we will see mathematically how obtain in general the steady state solution. Basically, this you will see corresponds to an integral of trajectories, but this is not the constructive way we use to do this in general. We will also see that it is possible to calculate the steady state solutions, and we will do this for certain classes of inputs, in particular the one we have normally in linear systems, so step functions, polynomial inputs, sinusoidal and cosinusoidal inputs. It is also possible to obtain these solutions simply by looking inside the system in a very simple way. And we will see also this. Okay, obviously, the characterization of the steady state solutions is very important because the parameter of these steady state solutions are used in general also for in the control design step. So if we want that a certain system behaves in a certain manner, we have to look obviously not only at what happens before the steady state response, but also at the steady state response. So we will see that basically the entire solution, when you apply an input, may be decomposed in two parts. The last part is the steady state solution, and the first part is what we call a transient solution. So it's the transient behavior of the system before fitting to, in some sense, to the final behavior, which is the steady state behavior. Okay. So what in first of all, what is a steady state? If you want to define exactly the steady state behavior, the steady state response obviously we have to look both at the steady state, so two different words, steady state and state, which is the state of the system. Steady state means at infinity in time. So steady state response may be state or output response. According we look at the X state or the output Y. So we have both an output steady state response and a steady state response. So let's begin with the steady state response. So we say that XTSS is the steady state response for the system x dot equal to ax plus bu with a given input u. So we have a specific input given. So in general, you will see also in the notes that we denote this dependency by saying that depends on u, but not on x0. So if basically we have the following two things. So XDSS is a solution of the system. Okay. This means this. So this is the first property. So we are looking in particular at a solution. And the second property is that all the solutions of the system tend to this particular solution. So this is what we mean by steady state. State response XDSS. So it's the solution to which all the other solution will tend asymptotically. Okay, so the situation is this. We have only one solution to which all other solution will converge, like in the previous example. The previous example, the solution is constant. So it's a constant solution and all solutions tend to that constant solution, which is XSS. Okay. So how to find these particular solutions? So first we see theoretical result basically, but however then is also used to calculate if we want practically the steady state solutions. Okay, so to state this result we have to right. So far, if you remember, if we consider x dot equal a x plus b u, okay, the solution is this. Okay, this is the solution such that it is x0 at t equals 0. So its initial condition is x0 at time 0. And the solution we consider starts from zero on, okay? And then runs for the subsequent times. Okay, actually it is possible to write the solution starting from x0 at any given time, so not only 0. But for example, at any given time t0. As we will see, this is nothing but the translation of the previous solution exactly by t0. So if you let's start the solution from t0, basically you will translate this solution by t0. So let's put this t here as usual. Okay, x0 t0 u. Excuse me, I forgot u above. Let's correct. The notation, if I remember well, is this actually. Okay, let's correct. Okay. So xt x0 t0 u is nothing but the solution such that it is x0 at t0, so not anymore 0. So you see we are using t0 inside here, and t, which is the running time. Okay, and so and runs for t greater or equal than t0. Okay, so in general this would be different from the previous. So it is easy to see that this solution is the following one, and you see it'll be basically it is the translation by t0 of the previous solution. Okay, obviously you see that if you take t0 equal to 0, you get back what we had before. So why we want to have this? Because this is useful exactly to characterize the steady state solution, in particular in this with this formula. So the following formula, which we'll write, gives exactly the steady state solution under one important assumption, which is the asymptotic stability of the system. So this is the primary condition for existence of steady state solution. In general, if you have a not stable system, physically the steady state behavior of the system will be meaningful, and typically the behavior is that you may even define a steady state solution for a not stable asymptotically stable system, but the problem is that typically the steady state will be now dependent from initial conditions. So it is not anymore physically what or the behavior of the system independently of the initial states, asymptotic. so will be something else. However, what we want is exactly the situation for which we have a well-defined steady-state solution, steady-state behavior. And this happens only for an asymptotically stable system. So it's very important to have this important property that the system be first asymptotically stable. So first of all, you have to guarantee that your system is asymptotically stable. Then, for many inputs, we'll see, basically you have what we defined as steady state behavior. Okay, so let's first assume that the system be asymptotically stable. So this is our first assumption. Then we rather for some technical, mathematically technical details, we assume or we limit the class of inputs we consider in this way. So we assume that for all t, notice t negative or positive. So for all t, the norm of the input is less or equal than a certain constant k c multiplied an exponential of kt and a certain polynomial. Okay. Okay, this condition is very general in the sense that many, many inputs are inside this class. For example, you see any exponential, any sinusoidal, any cosinusoidal function or any polynomial function is inside this class of inputs. So many, many actually inputs are inside here. Okay, so asymptotic stability, a technical condition, which is this on the input, but it's quite general, I should say. Basically, all the inputs we are interested in are satisfying this. Okay, under these conditions, the steady state state response XSST U is exactly given by the limit for t0, which tends to minus infinity, of the solution xt, x0, t0, u, exactly the solution we defined before. So starting from t0 with input u and with value x0. So it is exactly the limit of this solution if you let tend t0 to minus infinity back. Okay, on the other hand, this, if you remember that we are assuming that the system is asymptotically stable, you can eliminate from xt, x0, t0 inside this limit exactly the unforced part, because this will go to zero for sure. The system is stable. So as a matter of fact, this basically reduces to this formula. Okay, so it is nothing but the forced solution which we have to consider. So you see, this is exactly the forced part of the previous solution. Okay, so the steady state response is exactly defined, is equal. This is a result, a theorem. Is equal to this limit. So you take this solution, xt, or if you want only the first part here, and you calculate the limit for t0, which tends to minus infinity. So this gives you the way to calculate these solutions. Actually, we will see there is another way of doing this. Okay, we will not prove this result. However, you find the proof on the notes. Okay, so in the same way we can obtain YSST U, which is the steady state output response. Okay, this is easier once we know the steady state response, because remember that y is equal to cx plus du. So the steady state output response is obtained from this formula using the steady state response. So will be equal by linearity exactly to this. So once you calculated the steady state response, you have immediately the output steady state response in this way. Using the definition of output. Okay, so now we'll see how to calculate these steady state solutions in a certain number of cases. So in particular, first we will consider polynomial inputs, then we will consider sinusoidal and cosinusoidal inputs, exponential inputs, translated inputs, and linear combinations of inputs which admit for the system a steady state behavior. Okay. So in general, we will be able to calculate steady state solutions in many cases, in such a way to exactly understand what's the behavior, asymptotic behavior of the system responding to inputs. Inputs of this form, which are the most common. Okay. So we start with polynomial inputs. Okay, in particular we consider canonical polynomial. Remember Laplace transform, we considered already these kind of functions. And here we consider exactly the inputs of this form. So k is greater as an integer and greater than or equal to zero. So in particular, you see, for k equal to zero, we obtain the step input, the unit step input. Okay, so let's begin with the XSS function. So remember that the way to obtain this is this limit. Okay, so basically what you have to do first is to calculate this integral. With u equal to the given input. This will be a function of t and t0. So first the indefinite integral inside here, and then calculate in between t and t0. And then the limit. Okay. So what you obtain? Okay, we will not do this. You notice that this is not a difficult actually integral to do, because you can, the exponential matrix contains exponential, sinus, so this is a quite standard integrals, in general solved by parts. Okay, so this is not our task here. So basically we arrive at the end of the calculus and we get this. Okay. So we get that xt ss u, when we have polynomial inputs, canonical polynomial inputs, is equal to this. Excuse me. Okay. I will correct. This. Okay, so minus the sum going from j for j from 0 equal to 0 to k a inverse to j plus 1 power b t to k minus j over k minus j factorial. Okay, we should say immediately one